you probably have gospels that are your favorites, you know, 2 or 3 or 4 that you think were better, that you get more of a charge out of, and make more sense, that are more encouraging or invigorating for you. This is one of mine. You might imagine it would be. But what Christ is saying to the apostles is all of these beautiful images of nature. He's talking about human nature and the work of God, the grace in, with, and through our human nature in Christ. And he said, it is kind of a mixed up mess, but you can't go in and fix it by destroying everything that's imperfect in order to perfect the mystery of life. The imperfections are part of it, the mess is part of the deal. So for God, if you've ever seen my office or my car, it's never very neat, or my house. And in fact, I guess I was thinking back, I think I kind of grew up that way in the 40s. Mom and Daddy bought an old dairy barn out just south of the hill country, out north of San Antonio. And they built it into a house. We moved into it, I think, in 1947 or 48, before it was finished. And they kind of laughed, it never did ever get finished. They never quite finished it. And they would say, if our boys seemed to act like they were raised in the barn, they'd come by and act like. We had a large extended family, and we had a few kind of snooty uncles. I think probably most families have a few, and it's kind of interesting, kind of looking down their nose at everything. So they would come over and say, well, today, you know, Roy, when are you going to fix that screen door? That screen door is hanging loose, or it's ripped, and your dog's going in and out of it, or whatever. He said, that's not, we'll fix it later. Come on, sit down over here and have a drink. Trying to kind of power over. Well, what about that? Oh, you got that old Chevy truck out there under the mesquite tree. When are you going to get that thing started? It seems like that thing's always sitting out there leaning against the mesquite tree. Well, we're fixing it, too. We're going to work on it later. Come on in and have a drink. Well, one of the things he did, he was always very good natured about it. Well, it seems like slobs can usually put up with neatness pretty well. They don't mind the neatness. They're never noticed by slob, just different sets, different. Two different looking things from two different directions. You know. I guess the slobs too do get upset too if the neatie comes in and starts trying to straighten up their stuff. But Dad just laughed about it and thought, well, we need to calm these guys down a little bit. And so my sister had this beautiful Shetland pony. He looked like a pony out of a picture book. Beautiful. It was kind of a chocolate brown color, and he had a long mane, blonde head. Beautiful pony. His name was Firecracker. He was born on the 4th of July. Well, Daddy taught Firecracker to walk into the kitchen. And he, of course, he trained him to do that. He would open the door, and I don't know what the signal was, but he'd give Firecracker the signal. Firecracker would walk right into the kitchen. There was this old, big old Franklin stove where they'd build a fire in the wintertime. You could cook on a barbecue or put a pot of beans. They'd sit around the stove and talk. Well, so one time, one of the snooty uncles was there, kind of looking down his nose and everything. When are you going to fix this? When are you going to fix that? How come this is like that? And I don't know, what's the last time you cut that grass down there in front of the yard and all that? Anyway, Dad said, come on in, sit over here by the stove and we'll have a drink and talk. Well, he had trained Firecracker to walk in. So Dad opens the door. You see, we'll open the door a little bit, get a little fresh air in here. He gives Firecracker a signal. Firecracker comes just walking right into the kitchen. Straight, neat, clean. Well, you end up missing life completely. But the old farmer is telling the slaves, let's go out there and tear out everything that we don't want. Let's go out there and tear up everything that's not wheat. He says, the farmer pretty much is telling him, if you can't put up with the mess, you're not going to be able to put up with life at all. Life is pretty messy. If you think about it, it is. But it's beautiful. And that's what the farmer's saying. And through it all, the Lord is at work. Good stuff is coming up. But what about all this mess? Well, it's going to be part of the deal, too. At the end, when we get to heaven, all that's good and true and beautiful will reach its fullness and will leave the mess behind. But we may even be able to look back and see that some of the stuff we thought was a mess was really part of God's goodness at work, or something rich and beautiful and something invigorating. Coming to us, not in spite of a mess, but in the midst of a mess, by way of a mess. One of the things I just learned gradually, as a priest, I guess really as a priest, I learned it. I spent one summer with Father Ted Pfeiffer in the Isthmus of Tehuantepec, and he was really the closest thing to a doctor that they had down there. He would train with doctors in the hospitals, and he'd tell them, when I get down there, I'll be the only one who knows anything about medicine. Everything he could teach me. He would pull teeth, deliver babies. I remember one time he knocked on my door in the middle of the night. He said, Roy, get up. We got something to do. And we went out to the little place. Some guy had gotten drunk and got in a knife fight. They had him laying out there on a stretcher with his guts spilling out. And he said, bring him in here. And he stuffed all his guts back in and sewed him up and filled him up with antibiotics. And he goes back up the mountain about 2 or 3 days later back to work. But anyway, spending the summer with Teddy was what an eye-opener. One of the things he said, when I've got a baby to deliver, I want you to come and help me. If you can't do anything else, just stand there and pray. So, but he was a handy bogey to get me, but he kind of prepped me for it. He said, now, Roy, this is going to be kind of something you've never seen before. It's going to be kind of messy, but it's really beautiful. This is God at work, but it's going to be kind of messy. And some of it works. Like a terrible childbirth where the baby was almost too big to be born, and all you mamas know about all this. But anyway, I learned, well, life begins pretty messy. And then I learned with the death of my own dad, and a lot of times I've been intimately connected with death. It even is pretty messy. Usually birth and death are pretty messy. But they're still beautiful. There's something beautiful and powerful there at work, something that we can't quite describe and can't comprehend, but it's there in the midst of that mess. There's this goodness at work. It's growing, coming through it all. And from birth to death, there's all kind of messes. The mess of being weak, sinful, and imperfect people is always with us. What he's telling them and telling us is, don't get too disappointed or deceived or angry about this mess. This mess is part of it. If you can't take the mess, you're almost rejecting life itself. You really can be rejecting life itself. Just enjoy the mess. It's a beautiful mess. And God is at work through it all and in it all. And it's all working out in ways that you're not able to perceive at all. Get to heaven, you'll see it. So as we offer the bread and wine, my time is up. We listen to Alabama sing. It's pretty much that. I'll read one verse out of it when we offer the bread and wine again. But pretty much they're saying what Christ was trying to teach you and me and the apostles at that time, and what the old farmer is saying to his slaves. Don't get too fired up, too offended by this mess. There's something wonderful.